Dear friends, I have the honor and privilege to introduce Mr. K.N. Rajagopalan in the 64th MindSpeak webinar. Mr. Rajagopalan is not only a good friend, but he is a very illustrious gentleman in the field of finance in India. And of course, especially in South India. Mr. Rajagopalan is, I'm introducing Mr. Rajagopalan as the chartered accountant in practice since 1975. With 45 years of standing in the profession and also a qualified company secretary, and is the managing partner of B. Thyagarajan and Company, very leading chartered accounting company in Chennai. He currently heads the consulting division of the firm. Mr. Rajagopalan has helped and guided a large number of corporates, small, medium, large, as well as jewelry industry corporates across South India. If you name any of the large chains or the large jewelry companies, his advice has been sought and he has given those advice and they have benefited from that advice over the last about 25 years. Mr. KNR, as he is fondly called by his clients and has by his friends and the industry, has a vast experience in turning around sick units under the MSME sector. He has designed and implemented and suitably given business models covering business strategy for businesses to become corporates or corporates to become successful. He is an effective speaker. Today you will be listening to him. He's a very effective speaker and has delivered numerous keynote addresses in many forums of the chambers of commerce, of educational institutions, of financial institutions, and various other platforms. He has authored also a very interesting book called The Quest for the Grail. The Quest for the Grail, which discusses in detail problems and constraints faced by MSME sector organizations and enterprises, and also given various solutions to the MSME companies and enterprises in their problems. A well-experienced gentleman, Mr. Rajagopalan, in fact, it has taken us more than a month to get him because of his busy schedule, and fortunately accepted to address MindSpeak today. We tried several times, but he was very busy. And we are thankful for Mr. Rajagopalan to say yes and address us today. He has great experience in banking and finance. He has also hands-on experience in financial re-engineering and management consultancy services to our industry. Definitely, many, many people in our industry, the jewelry industry, have benefited from his expertise. He has generated a lot of financial products as well, exclusively, extensively for companies in the industrial sector, and has retail knowledge of credit, treasury, risk management, and financial reporting. Last but not the least, I would like to tell you that he is also very well versed with family enterprises. He is able to give advice. Can everybody mute their mics, please? Okay. Therefore, with experience in family enterprises, he is also able to understand our jewelry industry very well. Thank you, Mr. Rajagopalan, again for accepting this invitation. And over to you, sir. Can you hear us, sir? I think you have to unmute, sir.
Very nicely put in a packaged form.
Thank you.
Let me take it over from you now.
Yes, sir. Please proceed.
Good evening, friends. I am K.N. Rajagopalan, Chartered Accountant from here. I am grateful to the organizers for having given me this opportunity to share my thoughts on the experience gained in the past 2 decades in the jewelry industry by serving as consultants for major clients, and also to share with you my views on the future of this industry. I just want you, please excuse me that I am not very fluent in Hindi, therefore I am opting only for English, but it be very simple English. You can all follow. Anything which has left, Mr. Vinod Bhai will definitely help you out to get the clarification post this session. With this small prelude, I will get into the main topic. The topic of the day, as you all aware of, what is the future holding for the jewelers? For the purpose of your convenience and also for better understanding, I divided into 6 chapters, namely trending risk perception of the industry and its mitigation plan, funding of the enterprise, enhancement of pricing power by the industry, improvement of market share, inventory valuation, and finally, the adoption of the new technology for sustainable growth. Before I really venture into each chapter in a detailed manner for you to understand, I would like to apprise you of the background of the industry and its current status now. You all know, slowly the industry is shifting from imperfect market to a perfect market condition. The fallout of that is that standardized products, transparency of board rate, making charges, stone charges, and everything, every other fellow, including the customer, everybody will know of it. This, the unique feature of the artisan has been left over, and only the oranges have been compared as it is. Therefore, definitely the margin shrinkage will be there when compared to the yesteryears. Secondly, definitely an element of polarization is taking place from unorganized sector to organized sector, but slowly but steadily it is happening. This will create a problem of scaling up for the operations. Many small traders or marginal traders either may be wiped out unless they are able to come up to the requirement. Thirdly, I'm saying the market size itself is shrinking. You are all aware, 8 years back, our imports were 1200 metric ton and 400 to 450 metric tons of the recycling gold we used, roughly 1600 metric tons, even including giving allowance for the bullion, roughly 1300 metric ton of gold was available for jewelry conversion. But unfortunately, now the imports are very low, as you all know. The recycling aspect also is very less. In the last 7-8 years, more than 40 to 50% of the volume growth has shrunk in this business. Of course, in the value terms, we are getting thanks to the gold price buoyancy. This is definitely making us to compete, thereby making some sacrifices in the pricing. You all should also know, jewelry industry is contributing 6% of the Indian budget. Previously, 6-7 years back, we were paying 12,000 crores, meaning 0.5% of the total budget of the central government. But now currently, we are paying 1,40,000 crores. More or less, we are a collecting agent for the government of India. The import duty has been multifold time. GST has come into prominence. With all that, 1,200% increase this particular industry is contributing, especially in the background of the shrinking market size of the industry. To put it in another way for you to easily understand, the profit after tax is 1 to 2% for the industry across the board, maybe excepting the one largest unit which is operating with a brand. The rest of the people are around 2% only. To earn 2%, we have to do 16% for the purpose of government. This is very ridiculous when compared to any other industry this particular industry, I put it to tremendous amount of strain. But from the point of view of the government, they say it's a conspicuous consumption. It is more or less not necessary for the people. Therefore, wherever the revenue is possible, government is taking, they got their own logic in telling that. Moreover, post 2008, the industry has started taking leverage. The excessive leverage of the balance sheet, ending in the borrowing from the banks, have resulted some of the defaults now, what you are hearing, and some of the companies have already gone into insolvency also. They're operating with a very wafer thin margin. Previously, you can all remember, the billing will be made in such a way for gold rate, KDM rate, stone weight, stone cost, making charges, and so on and so forth. That is how we created value for the end customer also. But now that simply all the product prices have been completely standardized because of the acute competition, the price is also going up. We are not able to get that kind of pricing power in the market. Moreover, in the vicinity of the gold price going up, and some of the gold which have been used as a saving instrument earlier, those beaten gold is not coming back to the system. It goes only to the NBFC and banks they are financing, and at least the people will be redeeming the material. Therefore, the real time growth also in the near future is not going to be there by this reason. There again, we are now entering into trending risk perception of this industry, about which we are going to talk in our first chapter. We therefore try to understand the cause and effect of this transformation and the specific areas in a detailed manner we are going to discuss now, so that some of corrective and proactive actions can be taken by the industry as a whole that may definitely give a legroom for us to grow in a sustainable manner. With this introduction, I am getting into the first chapter, namely trending risk perception and its management. We all know about the risk associated with the industry. You are already in the business. The fluctuating gold price movement, cyclical nature of the business, acute competition, then the shrinking of the market size, high level of government regulatory things. These are all already been accepted and tested. But some new structural risk also going to emerge, and already it's started doing it. One by one, I will try to make it clear to you. A paradigm shift is taking place in the saving habit of the customers. Previously, we all know, the gold is more or less a monopoly savings, especially in the rural areas, because people believed that gold gives them a definitely hedge over the inflation, and it also acts as a liquidity provider in the case of eventualities. But now a lot of competing substitutes have come into play. Even in the gold itself, there is a gold bond, ETF bond, MCX, and so on and so forth. Other than that, a lot of financial instrument has come in the form of equity and mutual funds. A small data point I will give it to you for your consumption. 1 lakh crore mutual fund 7-8 years back, now today 30 lakhs crores is the total fund. And along with the economy, in the next 6 to 7 years, it is likely to go up to 100 lakhs. You please understand how the money is going to be diverted. All the household saving is going to be diverted into financial instrument as the economy grows. This is one adverse point from the point of view of the gold trade. This is from the saving side. Coming to the expenditure side, socially we are all well-knitted, affectionate families. And for social obligation, marriage day, wedding day, daughter's marriages, auspicious day, and so on and so forth, we used to exchange gifts in the form of gold and gold ornaments. But now, the tremendous amount of competition has come from another set of items like iPhones, motorcycles, and other consumer discretionary item like white goods and all. Again, I will share a data point with you. In the last 10 years, these kind of items in aggregate have grown by 10 times. In fact, every year it gets doubled. 10 times it has increased. In the light of this, we have to see on the both on the saving side as well as the expenditure side, the gold is losing its sheen. But it has been taken by the new generation products, and especially the new generation people are also, they are not showing much interest in having a bulk of gold jewelry. They are preferring for some other items, as I told you. Another important thing, the real-time competitor for you is not the neighbor next to your door, a jeweler. He is just like you. He is sailing in the same boat. The real competition is going to come from an unknown person operating in a virtual place like Amazon, Alibaba, Jio platform, Reliance Retail, or Flipkart, etc., etc. They got a deep package. The resources are infinite. So either they will definitely create a price war. It may happen in another 4-5 years, even earlier also. Above all, the jewelry trade is family driven. The forefathers and their parents and to the children have come one by one. But the way in which the elders done the business is totally different from now. So they got some expertise and wisdom, no doubt about it, with due regard and respect to them. But in a changed environment, whatever the experience they gained has got of no consequences in running the business currently with all sort of these kind of difficulties. Moreover, the compulsion to grow itself is a big risk for us, because the larger units are preferred to grow vertically and also having a territorial expansion from district to district, state to state, and state to overseas also. There is always a linking fear in the mind of the other people. They also want to follow in suit. They want to grow territorially. But this very fact is a risk, because what are the sources they had? What are the advantages they had? We don't know. But at the end of the day, if you are going to go beyond our means, it will definitely be very, very difficult proposition for the jewelers. Another important area I thought about, regulatory rigmaroles. You please find a way. The customs duty has increased. GST, improper way it has been introduced. The adverse effect of demonetization, the industry started facing. Even today, after 3 years, assessment orders are coming, and high-pitched assessment orders are coming for most of the jewelers of their no fault of their. That is only the system mistakes. But above all, this kind of disturbances asking us to report on a daily basis to various authorities. 2 lakhs rupees and above pan has to be produced. What is 2 lakhs rupees to weigh 25-30 grams? If this is a way in which the government is going to ask us, any number of people starting from the ordinary income tax office to the higher ups, FERA, and so many other people can have an easy access to the industry. This again creates a point of a dilemma in the mind of the people, whether at all we have to grow in these circumstances. What is there in store? We don't have a free will to operate. So this is another pandemonium. This is another problem which the industry is now currently facing. Yeah. Most important thing is that because of this significantly higher import duty levies by the government, there is always a huge difference between the international price and the Indian price. Therefore, most of the time, in spite of all surveillance and other thing, it results into smuggling. That the differential price is so heavy, anybody will be tempted to buy. Therefore, the orderly way of industry growing, it will definitely be curtailed by these kind of hindrances which normally we take. Therefore, the challenges are plenty, and we have to adapt to the changes. It is therefore so very difficult to manage the current situation, and there should be a definite plan or program in our mind how we are going to mitigate these loss, this risk as perceived by us. Most of them are real, maybe degree may vary. With that, I am now getting into, in this background, how we have to manage to just ward off these kind of It is anyhow, it is going to be real, it is going to be there here. How we are going to ward off this, mitigate this risk problem? First and foremost is that broad base your customer base by mining the data of the customer, his gender, occupation, address, relatives, profile, age group, and his preferences, earlier bill, how much he has taken, what are the preferences of the family, and all this data we can capture. We have to seriously look into it. Then we will definitely identify the real-time customer and we can retain him. Second important thing is that learn to coexist with large sized firms. What I mean by that, still there is an opportunity in the industry. We can coexist with the large sized firms because they got their own problems. Their problems of under capacity utilization, their problem of taking huge risk of inventory management, their problem of high level of leveraged books and the highly leveraged balance sheet and asset liability mismatch, and so on and so forth. Therefore, in a given opportunity, we can definitely coexist. We need not extinct from the business. We will coexist with the large sized firms also. Then we have to identify our audience. After all, next 20 years, the only younger generation, they are going to rule the roost. If that be the case, we should know the taste. How much they are willing to spend, in what manner they are willing to spend, how to bring them to the shop, how to motivate them to buy, how to improve the presentation. It's all from the point of view of the younger generation. The older people, they already know about the gold jewelry much better than what we know. Another important thing, we have to be a localized player with brand loyalty intact. What I mean by that, each city enjoys, because suppose a jeweler is 20, 30 years in operation in a city like Madurai, you will definitely enjoy a tremendous amount of goodwill. Trustworthiness will be there. Then the connectivity will be there. The owners knows the customer. So these are all the things we can make use of it. We have to enlarge it. Therefore, instead of concentrating and getting away in a way only to grow, getting you to another district or another state, is better to deeply involve yourself in the localized area itself and try to preserve your client and do not leave them to some other customer, some other company. Very important thing, we have to be in the changed environment to be regulatory compliant. All the areas of regulation, if you are not attending to now, it will definitely backfire you at some point of time. So we should be very clear, clean books, clean records, clean reporting. This is all a permanent thing. Whether we like it or not, we have to fall in line with that. Do not divert funds from the core business activity. Come what may, the industry really requires more money. And every year after year, when the gold price is going up, the working capital requirement definitely goes up. Even to do the same quantity, we have to put another 40% more now. So any fund diverted, even earlier days also, when the funds are diverted to real estate, that is not giving any return. It's except for the purpose of using for collateral security for the bank to get loan. Simply no appreciation is available for last 10 years. It is not bound to be there for another 10 years also. Therefore, this aspect is we have to carefully look into. Expand operations to various product mix. What I mean by that, let us not be what we are doing, only gold ornaments, silver ornaments, vessels, piles, then any other equal in input, diamond, precious stones and all. Because the customer once come, his income level goes up. He will not continue to be buying only chain. He will be interested to buy antique. He may be interested to buy any fancy item. He may be interested to buy any huge gift item also. Therefore, in order to retain the customer, and only for buying one thing, he should not get out. Once he gets out, probably the chances of his coming back is very, very minimum. Then we have to be a acclaimed retailer and not a jeweler ultimately. What I mean by that, a jeweler is always a jeweler. A retailer means a brand is always attached. You not only promote your own products, you buy the best of the brands in the market, even international market, as they need to be, and present it to your customers. And thereby, you are enlarging the scope. And at the same time, the cost of servicing the client in a showroom-like thing is going to be very, very costlier. In order to recoup the cost, you have to necessarily travel not only with your products, but also a similar products manufactured by somebody else, maybe a big people or a small goldsmith coming and giving, or small goldsmith or a diamond merchant asking a space for you, and he wants to do it on a consignment basis. It can be any form. It has to be done. Then the next important thing, that whenever you want to grow, it should always be asset-less model. Do not buy a property. Even if you want to improve your retail outlets within the territory in which you operate, because that is where you get the brand equity. Do not go from Hyderabad to Delhi. Be Hyderabad to Vijayawada, Madurai to Coimbatore, something like that. Within the territory in which people know your product and know you, is mostly the trust-based business. Do not buy a property, but try to lease it out. The best choice, according to me, is that you got a brand, you got an access to the best of the designed products, and you got the supply chain, everything you got under possession. Then what is not having is only the capital to support. There are so many people who are interested, high net worth people. They are able to get 2-3% more than the marginal return what they get from the banks without any risk whatsoever. They are interested to take over the franchisee from you. When you do the franchisee, it's a win-win situation. We are getting our cake, and that man also getting his share of income on return on investment. Therefore, this is a way, if you grow, you are not unduly growing your balance sheet, but at the same time, your profit and loss account will grow. This is a very important thing which you can think of. Another important thing, based on my experience, I find that a war chest has to be managed, maintained by the company. What I mean by war chest is accumulation of cash. At least 20% of your total working capital should be in the form of cash or cash equivalent. Why this is required? This is required to make use of the opportunities thrown open by the economy. Probably it may be a joint venture, or it may be acquisition of some other brand, or it may be an acquisition of the business down the line, or it can even be to accumulate the inventory when in a falling market. A cash in hand will do wonders to you. It may look like idle to you, but it's definitely, it is not idle. It only creates, it propels value for the next growth phase. Therefore, the cash is a necessity. You, in this kind of business, there always come some sort of eventualities. To face that eventuality also, the having cash will definitely give you comfort. So this is what we call it as a war chest. Another important point is that most of the jewelers on earlier 10 years back, they were not borrowing from bank at all. If you go and ask your fathers and forefathers, they will tell you that there is no charm in borrowing anything. There is no need. They made money even without borrowing. But now, under compulsion of expansion, the most of the jewelers have been put into borrowing at a different scale of requirement. Here, you be very, very careful. Ring fence your private assets in case you are necessitated to borrow from banks. What I mean by ring fencing, it's very simple. You are already giving a primary security. You are also giving the securities of the company to the banker. Unwittingly, the banker will get into you and ask for a personal guarantee and ask for the properties. But please refrain. That can be done once your balance sheet is good. Your credit rating credentials improve, then definitely we can sit with the banker and you can definitely ask them not to insist on the personal guarantee, because these are all the properties earned by the family for 100 years. There is no meaning in one generation we are giving that, and especially for not able to face any eventuality, the banker will be the last mile friend. Whenever something is good, they will participate. They smell something bad, they will be the first person to get out of the boat. So that kind of relationship normally the bankers used to have. There again, try to maintain your market share. In order to mitigate all this risk, whatever I told you as a perceived risk, impending risk, you please try to maintain your market share. If you are not able to improve, doesn't matter, because market itself is shrinking. At least maintain the share. There again, hedge unsold inventory. Normally the jewelers are all thinking the gold price goes up, their asset value also goes up. It is not so. Unfortunately, it is not so. The asset is only for an individual as an investment. For a business asset, it is just like any other stock in trade. If somebody does it with salt or sugar, you are doing it with the diamond and the gold. So for you, it is a business asset. Remember, It took 8 years for the gold to come back to the current position of 1950. You all remember in 2013 July, it touched $1,927 per ounce. Thereafter, after 8 years, it took to come back to the original level. But Indian context, it is different because the government is taking away the major cake. But in international context, it is nothing. Even if you put it correctly in US dollar terms, at that time, dollar was 104 index. Today, dollar index is 92 and off. If you take that, it is still not reached to the 1927 of yesteryear. It is still hovering around 1800 only. But optically, it gives you a feeling as though people are making huge money in gold, and the gold jewelers are minting money, and they are the people, the targeted people, and somehow, just like that, they are making money without putting any effort. These are all the rumors. These are all the things happening in the country. Do not be carried away by the price increase. Because after all, at the end of the day, if you sell 10 grams today for 5,000 rupees, it's 50,000 rupees. Next day, you have to sell. You have to immediately buy in the market for same 50,000 rupees. It is only replenishment cost. Where is the question of appreciation? Where is the question of escalated profit you are taking? Actually, you are taking indirectly risk. This price has to manage, maintain. Suppose it comes down, we will take a further risk. Therefore, under these circumstances, expecting something good is going to happen, do not over leverage your balance sheet. With that, I am getting into the next chapter. This chapter is called Funding of the Enterprise. How to fund? This is very, very important. Traditionally, jewelers used their own funds for business. Very rarely, jewelers got into banks for borrowing. Post 2008 financial crisis, gold as alternative asset worldwide came into prominence. It had become a safe asset. Safe asset based lending, that too with a lot of collateral security. There again, the real estate market was booming at that time. The bankers thought it's a risk free investment. They started to finance gold both under cash credit and metal loan category. Metal loan is available at 3% interest with the hedging advantage. Most of the organized players opted for the leverage. This advantage enjoyed by the organized sector enabled them to do the business by opening new branches, territorial expansion, vertical expansion, horizontal expansion, everything they did it. During this period, why this actually happened, I will give you a background. In 2008, a financial crisis has come in the international market in US. Lehman Brothers failure and all. Subsequent to that, gold got into prominence because it's a safe haven asset. Even now it is happening during COVID condition, gold again going up. Then what has happened? The money become very cheap in America. The funds started moving into the third world country, including India. The excessive money is available. India is only a growing destination. At the time, India was growing at 8 to 9%, not like today, 3.5 to 3%. So the everywhere infrastructure is taking place. Lot of capital in investments have been committed by the bankers as well as the owners. That is a real growth pace we had, but we are not fully utilized it. That's a different point of view. But there is a compelling investment. Therefore, more money came in. Then the bankers started to invest in gold in industry because they are doubly sure. One, the gold price is improving. Real estate, which they have taken as collateral security, is also improving. Therefore, they are very sure. And they are just passed on that benefit in the international pricing to 3% to metal loan wala. But what has happened suddenly? By 2013, when the entire gold market collapsed, it has fallen from $1,927 to $1,000 near about within the matter of 5 to 6 months. The people are not able to manage the mismatch which is created in asset liability of their balance sheet. With the result, what the bankers did, the margin money could not be paid on the metal loan because all of a sudden last 1 week it kept on moving like anything. So the people could not sell it in the market and realize cash and make the payment for margin for metal loan. But unfortunately, bankers could not tolerate and wait. They have an option to all these people. I will convert all this metal loan into cash credit account. You please follow me now. Very, very closely follow me. From 3% interest, the bank charged 13% interest on cash credit account. Nearly 400% more interest they taken from us for a business which is dwindling. But actually, the liabilities has started blooming. Next to 2-3 years, it's a constant market, so-so market. Nothing great has happened, but the interest cost has zoomed. As against giving 3% for 3 years, they ended up paying 50% on the total amount. Then what has happened? together with that capital expenditure also people committed due to the better days ahead, but nothing has happened like that. Ultimately, the cheap money enabled the adventurous person to escalate the business, but unfortunately, more than dozens of the people have fallen sick. Industry wise, they become defunct. Some of them may become bankrupt also. During this process, I want you to recollect, dozens of companies got into listing platform in India. Most of them went into listing with the idea to get better leverage from the bank. Suppose you bring in 1 rupee equity, the banks are prepared to pay 3 times. Therefore, all of a sudden, they can improve the balance sheet size 3 times, 4 times within a matter of 3 years. But none of the, except one or two, none of the newly listed jewelry industry is now available in the market. Either they are dead and gone, or they have been very, very abysmally penny stock. This is erosion of confidence of the investors also taken place incidentally by these over-ambitious people. With this, unfortunately, all these things led to strain in the financial indicators, mainly on the one part, the shrinking of sales by the failures and bankruptcy, trust deficit, and the unwillingness on the part of the banker even to give to the genuine firms. This all has created a pandemonium in the industry. The banks become jittery and made a lot of knee-jerk reaction of restricting even the genuine people to access the legitimate credit from the banking system. In this background, funding access is to be taken care, particularly working capital intensive model. It is better and wiser for larger outfit to depend on the borrowing or working capital requirement, preferably in the manner in which I now going to discuss with you. This I got out of my experience. 7-8 years we had kept on working on this model, and finally we approved and we adopted. It found to be very, very successful. I am now going to talk about the probable future funding model of the industry. 1/3 of the total working capital requirement should be funded by banks in the metal form, but a small portion can be kept as cash credit because the margin calls have to be taken care of. Second 1/3 should be invariably out of the customer advances and vendors dues. Why I'm specifically telling is that it's a pre-sold item. As far as customer advance is concerned, after 3-4 rotation, automatically it is a pre-sell item. In the case of vendors, to smoothen the process of delivery mechanism. Otherwise, if a no due means in an emergency period, they will not be inclined to give you. Only to collect the earlier bill, they will be interested to give you. This is a kind of psychology that people used to get. Third and important is that 1/3 should come out of our own internal accruals and retained earnings. If this is a model, just I will go through by giving example. Previously, we used to borrow up to 75%. 25% will be creditors or our own fund. But there at 13% interest, it works out to 40% over a period of 3 years. But here, 3% only we are paying, it works out to only 9%. In effect, your cost of funds gets reduced to 20%. If you have to pay 100 at the original method, now it is enough you pay 20 rupees only. More so, everything self-generating, self-effacing liability. Once a liability is created, only by way of sale we are going to extinguish the liability. We are not going to sell at a distress and try to get the liquidity and then pay off. It is not like that. It's a self-liquidation liability based on its own assets. Thereby, even in the worst eventuality, I made out my own program and the stress balance sheet, I worked out this. It worked out to be very, very convenient over a period of 3-4 years. Whatever we pay as excessive interest, if only we are able to garner and we are able to save, that definitely helps us to improve our working capital cycle as well as the comfort what we get otherwise. Another important thing I want to tell, the profits also, we call it as a capital allocation. Whatever the money you get it after meeting all expenditure, 1/3 of this should go to the income tax and other statutory liability, including gratuity and other provisioning. And the 1/3 can go jolly well to the shareholders to enjoy for the family to create some other assets. For why I am giving that leniently, because that money will always be coming back to the company in case it is required. Another one third has to be religiously kept within the system as a retained earning. So if this is a composition, ultimate cost of funds will always be less, but you will try to enjoy all the benefits attached with the working capital cycle mechanism. This way of doing it will definitely not strain your balance sheet. Not only the balance sheet will be contracted, your P&L account also will get enlarged, because it is giving an access to the funds that will help you to improve your working capital cycle. Thereby, whatever be the given gross profit margin, instead of 3 rotation, if you are able to do 4 rotation, the additional money will get into the bottom line, and is a virtuous circle. It keeps on moving like that. And this is how we have to look at it, the funding side. Then the third chapter, we are getting into pricing power. How to improve the pricing power. This is very important aspect of business. Normally, pricing is determined by, you all know, brand, trust, and services established over a period of time. The interconnectivity between the customer and the supplier always makes it some sort of premium. Sale is to be linked to your product ordered and not to be shown in the shelf. What I mean by that, it looks like a tailor-made order, and the profile should be displayed in that way. Uniqueness is to be preserved. For example, I will tell you on uniqueness category. There is one jeweler in Tamil Nadu. He is monopolizing the waist chain. We call it Odiyanam. Waist chain. Anybody has to buy only from him. No other jeweler has got that, because it is very old item. Lot of material has to go into. But the premium he enjoys 3-4%, and the similar product is something noteworthy. Like that. A chain may be a small chain. Chain normally being sold as a commodity, cost plus. But in the chain, if you are able to make some carvings, some sort of improvement in design, but simply it looks like a chain, instead it will look like a sophisticated chain. Definitely you may get 2-3% more as a pricing. So some of the time, common items will get a better price provided the people know that you are the supplier. In a shrinking market side, only value creation will survive. In this case, I am now reminded of a story, a small story. A son kept on asking a father, what is the value of life? Then the father told, narratively I cannot explain, I will give an experiment to you, you yourself will understand. Then he has given a stone to him and asked him to go to the nearby bazaar, sit in the platform, and call for inquiries, but do not sell. Come back and tell what is the price they are prepared to pay for this stone. One fellow asked 100, 200, finally 500. The boy came back to the father, why for such a differentiating people are prepared to pay 500? Okay, you don't worry about it. Tomorrow you go to the high street shop, take a small space in a good shop, and then come back and give me your feedback. There somebody offered 2000 rupees, the second customer 3000, another customer 5000. He came back and told with all joy, Appa, what an amount of differentiation. The high street fellow is prepared to pay me 5000 rupees for that. Something fantastic I never known. Other fellow told only 500. Then the father told, don't get excited, Baba. Last time, you please go to the largest jeweler of this city. Ask them to get an audience to meet the owner himself. Then whatever the feedback he gives, please come and tell me. Then he waited for the owner. Owner came and called the boy. And what is that you are holding? Stone. Fantastic. What is this stone? He will it be 50,000 rupees? He asked. Then this fellow has got surprised and shocked and came back and told the father. So for the lesson here is that maybe exhaustively, what I'm telling you is exaggeration, but it really happens in lifetime. The value is always decided by the giver. That is a taker. A customer knows what he wants. As long as you are able to service to the requirement of the customer and you are able to place yourself nearer to the customer, definitely you will get a better pricing. The cost plus is everybody knows. The content is gold plus some making charges. Everybody knows. But somebody is able to prepare to pay for it. You may ask me a question. Does it happen in jewelry industry also, sir? Yes. The largest jeweler in India, you all know about it, he is selling the gold coin with 5% markup on the board rate. How many of you are able to get 5% markup just for a gold coin? The customer also knows it is only a gold coin. The purity parameters, it is same as that of any other jeweler, 916. But at the end of the day, he is prepared to pay 5% more. Therefore, repeatedly, he cannot be a fool. He gets a pride of possessing that particular brand in his house. So that is where the brand value comes into operation. Please remember, you are all capable. Each one of you can definitely make product pricing. Don't assimilate into cost plus. It's all only for verification purposes. But the value is totally different. Value is always determined by the customer. You have to give the support system to him. You have to present it in such a model which appeals to him. You have to create an impression that he always carry a pride and a perception. It has got a resale value. It has got so on and so forth. One by one, you are able to teach him, educate him. Even any item from your shop can get you 2 to 3% more. You all may feel 2 to 3% is a big money. Yes, it is a big money. When the balance sheet shows only 2% post-tax profit in an average in the industry, getting 2 to 3% more in the top line, it is equivalent to getting 100% more in the bottom line. Therefore, it is not a mere money. Everywhere, getting 2 to 3% is nothing for you. You have to only motivate yourself. You be convinced that you are not competitor. You are not competing with the outsider. You are selling your own product. And the product into which you got a complete loyalty factor to support, and you are sure and certain that product is of a genuine nature, and all the purity parameters are in tight. Therefore, after all, at the end of the day, the gold cost making additionally 3 to 4% is not going to make the customer poorer. A satisfied customer will never mind paying that extra money in an already bloated market. Market price. Therefore, the pricing you have to take care of. However small you can do this, however medium scale you can do it. It is not necessarily to a large people. It is all the intention mindset that is more important. How to improve the market share? It is our next chapter. This has to be looked from the shrinking market size. It means wherever you are, you have to push into certain proactive steps at least to retain your share, as I told you in the initial observation. Concentrate on product that you are familiar with. That is the Vodiyanam story, what I told you. It's a quite commendable. Understand fully the customer preferences and his standing. Do not compete in commodity category. Because competing in commodity category, always first thing comes into the price only. Nobody is going, they will ask, give me that Chavitri chain for. There's another Jaishirya chain for. They themselves know what is the price. But try to avoid in competing in the commodity segment. Have a unique segment, niche segment. It may be small, but still the enlarged profit you will get out of that. And the good clientele you get out of it is not a also ran category. You will get a specific, well appreciable, good quality customer base. You can get it. Be a value creator, not a product seller. Just like that, ask the people to sell something and get away. Not like that. This will suit you. This is a pride position. This way you look very nice. Any change of changes you want, you can make it. Something like that, you have to keep on conversing with the customer and try to get this loyalty. Territorial expansion in the areas you are familiar with. That is repeatedly, I'm telling. Wherever you are, suppose you are in Bangalore, near about Mysore or Sitaraguga or those places you can go. A person is in Coimbatore, he can get into Tirupur, Erode or Chelam. But there's no meaning in somebody from Coimbatore going to Vijayawada or Hyderabad. It is not necessarily, I don't think you will not succeed. I'm not telling. What I'm telling you, to make yourself a footing itself takes 10, 15 years for you. Huge inventory you have to carry. Places like Vijayawada, Hyderabad, they're all big malls. There are very big retail showroom. Minimum 400, 500 kgs you have to give. That's a huge cost. Therefore, that kind of return you will not get. The cost of servicing will be much, much higher than the incremental return you are getting by putting into that kind of stocking in that particular retail outlet. Therefore, improve your product mix. As I always repeatedly telling you, improve your product mix. Attract the young generation to bring in future business. Try to market by using your own retail brand, but similar product to enlarge your vicinity. Be visible to attract new customers also. Contribute to social functions. Like liberally to attract targeted customers. Concentrate on e-commerce platform. introduced new concepts like wedding sets, gift sets, specialty item, unique pieces display, and all. The brand ambassador at this level is not required for, honestly, I feel it is not required, especially if you're a celebrity in the nature of actor or actress. Your own product is a celebrity. Your own people behaving with your customer is a brand ambassador for you. The kind of business you are going to do, that is enough. You need not unnecessarily waste your money, but very purposefully, effectively, you can spend it to promote your own products and take a market share of your own. Always innovate. New design, new look, new pride, new novelty, and adapt to new thing wherever it is coming from. Because anything new is always been appealing to the customer base, especially the women folk. With that, I'm getting into the inventory valuation side. It's a very small thing. On request, I made this addition. Cost is relatable for first time charge of gold and other manufacturing expenses. You know about it. Market is fluctuating and highly flexible. Inventory value is to be considered only at the market price or the cost, whichever is lower, so that we don't commit on paying more taxes. Unrealized profit, we should not pay tax. For the purpose of continuity and certainty, valuation model should be always on a first in, first out method. People prefer the weighted average method. It's also okay. Therefore, the extremes could be eliminated. However, in case where gold, silver rate is lower than your cost of production, you should adopt the cost only based on current decreased price. It is common in gold industry to assume cost on metal to metal basis. That is all good for our own working. All the jewelers, I used to talk to them, they are very, very prudent player. You people are very, very prudent people. You always measure in terms of the metal to metal. Your profits or loss always depending on opening stock 100 kg. Closing is 110 means 10 kg I made profit this year after all expenses. This is very easy of understanding. There is no price element is involved. But unfortunately, accounting policies and standards are not based on the metal. It is based on the Rubana Paisa, INR. So in that case, we have to translate them into INR. To fall in line with the accounting norm, it has to be expressed in value terms only. Therefore, a better thing will bring more profits in books in an increasing metal price scenario and vice versa. Because once you adopt any other method, unnecessarily unrealized profit, we should not get into paying taxes. Because Indian tax structure is not something which is refundable. They may maximum, they may permit you to carry over the losses. There is no carry forward of losses. The composition of closing inventory, if constituted of own gold, metal gold, and party gold, how we have to value. In the case of own gold, it always goes with the first in first out method, that too on a original cost basis. In the case of customers also, once the gold has been taken over by us, it will be on the date in which we took over the gold. Till such time it is not sold, it will be slated as a value at the time of cost only. On that day, suppose the market value is less, we can adopt market value. Coming to metal loan is not at all a purchase. It is only a leased item. Metal does not belong to us. Every quarterly, we have to restate the liability in the books and revalue the metal based on the data given by the or the statement of account given by the metal loan banker. Suppose you got it 40,000, 40 lakhs, but the year end it is 45 lakhs. You can definitely put it 45 lakhs because you are going to create a corresponding liability of 5 lakhs also in your books. That 5 lakhs will be represented by the purchase item. And this 5 lakhs will be represented the closing item. Therefore, the net to net, there is no plus or minus in the valuation. But the modality is that because it is not owned by you, you have to do like that. Coming to the MCX valuation, somebody used to hedge it in the MCX platform. Their own gold, because the prices are all going up, people want to be very careful. They don't want to miss the bus. Probably they may go short in the MCX market. That means they're selling the item. But physically they are holding it. They are creating a sales entry through MCX. In such cases, how to value? The MCX is only a book entry. MCX is only a hedging instrument. MCX is not supported by any physical delivery. Therefore, that MCX portion, if it results in excess liability, you can write it off in your P&L account as a loss because you need not pay tax on that. On the contrary, the original stock which you are holding, you can continue to state only in the form of cost. you need not put it in the real time market value. Now you find the difference between the meta loan and the MCX. MCX is only a hedging instrument. MCX is not supported by the physical stock. Meta loan, it is supported by a physical stock. Meta loan is not your purchases. Therefore, every quarter it has to be restated. Absolutely all right. In the case of MCX, it's a very good point, because in a rising market, you are able to get the income tax benefit, because the corresponding metal is already, you bought your own material, which you are not sold. You are holding it. MCX is a fresh commitment which you are making to hedge. Therefore, the hedging loss can be set off, because you are only hedging your own product. You are not hedging cotton. You are hedging your own product. Therefore, the derivative department, it is absolutely available for cost adjustment. That is a profit adjustment. Absolutely no problem. You also understand another thing. When the prices come down, suppose at 55 lakhs, you paid 10 lakhs margin. At 45 lakhs, you went short. Up to 55 lakhs, pure gold went up. You paid 10 lakhs. It's a margin money which you paid. That 10 lakhs extra, as I told you, you can take it off for that particular year. But ultimately, when the margin, when the market start falling, the margin release what you get, the money, you can buy the real-time gold at a lesser price. You please follow me. Instead of 100 rupees, you will be now paying only 90 rupees to possess the same material, because already you are having huge closing stock. These adjustments we can make with the help of all these instruments, collectively, very judiciously, pragmatically, proactively done, it may result in a good return to you, apart from the normal operating profits what you aspire for. Now we are coming to the final chapter, adoption of technology. Technology is there, the way of life. All businesses, either manufacturing or servicing or even retailing, they have to adopt the latest technology to survive. We cannot keep the earlier way of accounts keeping. Things have to be corroborated. Things have to be integrated. All the data has to be permeated into information. And with the help of information, we have to do the data crunching. The data mining will give tremendous amount of input to you that will facilitate operationally also. Better understanding of the customer profile and his preferences will be known, because the last invoice what he made, you know, next invoice, if there is a repeat thing, you will find that that fellow is interested in gold. Or one time he bought gift article, another time he bought gold article. You can ask him, why not you take this time diamond? Diamond has not gone up in value, sir. Gold has gone up by 40%. Silver has gone by 25-30%. Diamond is more or less stable. Diamond is a very possessive thing. People are all aspired to hold a diamond. Why not you convert this time instead of buying gold? I'm just suggesting you. A lot of necklaces has come in a diamond. A beautiful looking. It is very good for your daughter. Something like that, stories can be always made. And the diamonds can be sold, because these are very price sensitive people will automatically fall prey to the diamond. Diamond is also a good material. And some point of time, it will also go up. This is how we can motivate people. As a source of building up the customer base. Because once you identify the customer, along with them, a lot of people will come. Especially in places like Madurai and rural area, even to buy a small wedding item, a lot of family members will come for auspicious and other to show the closeness to the bride. But take all the addresses, their own profile. We can have a multiplier effect. Instead of one family, we can make it over a period of time, 10% to come to your shop. Avoid duplication of work. This is definitely a tremendous advantage of adapting to technology, because only one time data is punched. After that, the data is being used for various platforms, starting from accounting, reporting, analyzing, data analytics, everything. Then accurate accounting and performance evaluation become very possible, because one time one clerk will give one information, another accountant will give something. One time they value differently, another time they will see differently. One set of things will be misrepresented. One branch account might not have been taken. These are all possibilities. Genuinely also it may happen. But once you are interconnect everything by an ERP system, you are able to accurately account the thing, and performance have been fully evaluated. You have to ascertain and assess the frequency of movement of various jewelry items. I mean that most of the people are under the impression antiques and temples and fancy items are giving us a much better return. In absolute terms, yes. Relative terms, I'm not sure. Why? Because ultimately at the end of the day, businesses are done to make the return on capital and return on equity. The chain will get a rotation of 8 times. maybe with 5% gross profit margin, it may give 40% return on a year-on-year basis. Whereas fancy material may give you 18% return, but only 1.5 times it will go. That means only 34%. Why I'm telling you, in the absolute terms of what looks as a very, very valuable item, priced item, people have always have a tendency to hold it. But by a flux of time, one day, suppose you are going to use 1 gram, 20 rupees interest you are paying on that. Please remember that. A non-movable item, whatever be the asset, it is a waste. From the business point of view, at 35 lakhs we bought something and paid 15 rupees interest. At 50 lakhs, the same quantity, we are now paying 35 rupees interest. Therefore, every one day for 1 gram, we are using 35. So our bandwidth itself is only 8 to 10%. 90% of the cost of the product goes into gold. The only 10% is available for us. Out of this, 3 to 4% is the maneuverability. If suppose you are going to wait for 3 months, 4 months to sell that, the entire superficial profit, which is otherwise available to you, will be lost to you. So genuinely, at the end of the day, if you really work item wise return, some of the items, especially the fancy item, which is non-moving item, but look nice, but people are only seeing, but they don't have affordability to take it. Or it is a very unique piece. It can be used only for a wedding or some other purposes. It is not a common use. Therefore, some reason or other, the gold price is very heavy. The wastages, I have to pay more to you. Therefore, I am stopping. I am deferring my purchases. All these things will come into play. Therefore, you please see, wherever the costly item is, you please go through your books and see, are you really making a return on investment of that costly item? On the other hand, common item, commodity item might have given you a reasonable, moderate return on investment. This aspect also will be very well known by the ERP analysis by absorbing to the latest technology. This also helps to fix the capital productivity. What I'm telling you, when the prices are going up, we continue to keep 1.5 tons. That's not good. What is our logic? Whether what, when the price goes up or comes down, what is the stock turnover we do in a year? Suppose you do 4 times. That means you can afford to have four tons in a year. That means you can afford to keep 1 ton or 1,200 kg. But you are only doing two times a turnover. Why the hell you should make 1,200? It's 800 is enough for you. The extra 400, we are all under the impression it is bound with some appreciation. Absolutely, there is no appreciation. When the market starts falling, the customer knows, they are very intelligent than us. They will come back and buy the item which we bought at a higher rate. Always the customer will get the last laugh. We will never get it. So therefore, your methodology should be not with respect to the appreciation of the asset, only with reference to the return on investment. Suppose you have invested 100 crores, what is the return I'm getting out of this? In this combination, in this product mix, in this territory, in this branch, by way of this, by way of that. This is more important. Because ultimately, at the end of the day, everything boils down to the return on investment. Therefore, the stock turnover is one of the best indicators to understand the return on investment. This particular concept of getting into the new technology helps you whether we can buy or sell. Can it be better to give it to the goldsmith or do it ourselves? Or can we buy it directly from the dealer? Or what is the kind of margin of safety this particular thing gives me? What is the margin of safety? They're very simple. Anything which I am getting more than the fixed cost recovery is a margin of safety for us. Up to that level, I can go and do my trading. Then better cash management. The cash, don't think, is a waste. Any amount of cash is available. It's always, as I told you earlier, it can be managed for better usage. The lean season inventory, you can determine. What are all the lean seasons? What are all the holidays? What are all the festival day? Which ethnic crowd buys what? In which area, what item goes? In a Muslim-dominated area, some particular product design will go. In a Hindu-dominated area, something else will go. This is all the experience we are gaining. But this particular data management, it will crunch all the data and straight away give it to you in a clear spot. Yes, this is how I have to make my reordering plan. The MIS information can be captured. The intensity of differential factors at work can be captured. Price differentiation, quality differentiation, purity differentiation, workman differentiation, design differentiation, innovation differentiation, uniqueness differentiation. All these things will be known if only you put the data into work. Most of the thing we all imagine something is happening. But in virtual reality, that may not happen. we may make out our own cost plus some pricing, but that may not really happen. Some we thought that it will go in 3 months, it may not happen. One promoter of mine, you knows that is a very good item, sir, it will go within 20 days I will sell, but even after 10 months it didn't go, because the taste and preferences of the customer who is really interested to buy, that matters, not your viewpoint, how it is good, how it looks like that and all. Ultimate test of water is only swimming. The only the customer has to ultimately decide. Above all, the reliability and transparency of records for even for outsiders like government agencies, and including the retrieval of such document, is become very, very easier. It may lead to better cost control and saving, besides getting better gross profit margin. This will ensure the company's competitive advantage in the very, very difficult situation like we are facing. E-commerce platform can also be integrated. Automated reordering will be done, just like bigger companies are giving nowadays, reordering, web connectivity, design making, and the product improvements, enable personal touch with the customers, interactive with the customer, talking to the customer in a different platform, video. There are so many things attached to the mainframe, thereby very, very easily in a given point of time we can get any type of interpretation. But whenever some data come, it is all reliable, it is all accurate, it can be relied upon. With this, I am coming to the conclusion of the 6 chapters specifically we have taken up today. Before I summarize it, I want to share some more thing with you. What all the thing you have to do, I so far enumerated. How to mitigate the risk, how to improve the pricing, how to improve the market share, how to use better the technology available, and so on and so forth. How to funding the company and all. Now there are equally some item, if you don't do this, you will be better off. Instead of venturing into do something great, if you don't do it, by itself you will be better off. I will name a few of them. Being a jeweler, do not speculate in gold other than for hedging purposes. Do not divert funds, as I told you, from the core business. Do not over leverage your balance sheet. What I mean by over leverage is excessive borrowing. Because the balance sheet sometimes may not be good, but your personal properties will be good. Banks may be inclined to take the personal property and start lending you. He knows where to, how to get, when to get the money. But by telling that your balance sheet is bad, he will be charging you 2-3% more than the market. In a good credited balance sheet, suppose you have to pay 8%. In this kind of balance sheet, in spite of you are a very good debt servicing person, you will be asked to pay 11% or 12%. So this continuously over a period of time, on an enlarged borrowing, if you are going to pay, you are committing unnecessarily 40-50 crores every year. Do not overtrade. You all know about it. Do not overstock. What I mean by overstock, I told you about the stock rotation. What is moving, hold it. If something is not moving, don't buy, don't hold it. Even if sometimes it's worth melting also. In a situation like this, and the prices are going up like anything, old item can even be melted and brought into the system as a new item, which has got a better life. Do not appropriate capital for a possible future, because I am only telling you possible future profit income. Income may be there, may not be there. It is contingent on happening so many things. But you are appropriating capital, something real. Do not get into anxious mood. Do not get into an ambitious mood. Do not follow somebody and try to invest. Sometime slowly in a phased manner you start investing, you will always reap the harvest. Do not go against the trend. This is very important. The trend is against you, please be calm. Even a ship like Titanic will fail in a turbulent sea. What is the advice for Titanic? It should be in the shores. It should not be in the middle of the sea. A giant company, a giant ship like Titanic can undergo this problem. Any institution at any point of time will definitely undergo. It may not be permanent, but that phase also will come. We should know how to manage that. Do not imitate the recent winner strategy for growth. You might have heard about so many new southern people emerging into northern area. So many people are getting into equity investment. So many people are having a 20,000, 30,000 retail outlets. Do not ever imitate them, because you know what you are capable of. You know what is your destination. You know what is really required to give comfort and a peaceful sleep in the nights. They may have a deeper packet. They may have a different version of the business model. They may be a huge risk taker. We don't know. But one thing is sure. Within 4 or 5 years, somebody is growing 5 times, 10 times and all. Ultimately, the ecosystem has proved that they are destined to fail for some reason or other. They become bankrupt. Their shares will not be listed. Even if it is listed, it will not be quoted. And they will get into doldrums. Well, very, very important thing is I'm telling is do not lose control of the business. You can give the authority. You can give the accountability, responsibility to any of the managers, especially in the territorial expansion side. But control of the business should always be with you, whether procurement, making, distributing, selling expenses, salary, compensation package, bankers, loan, credit rating, auditors, legal advisors, all these aspects which require owner's direct contribution, because you don't give it to the accountant because his understanding will be different. He will be interested only to file the return today. Why not tomorrow? You will not ask. By deeply reading, you may find some answer. Why not this year this income can be shown, sir? Why not it can be deferred? Why not this expenditure need to be capitalized? Why not we make it revenue? There may be hundreds and plethora of questions will come to you because you are the owner. You know how to run your business. You have been empowered to do your business. Therefore, I am very sure that no point of time you have to leave the control. You can leave anything to the people. Even the cash box you can give to the accountant. But definitely not dispense with the control aspect of the business. With that, I hope that I am coming to the final thing. Just simply summarize, just for another 2 minutes only to keep you agile. We are going through a difficult phase. It is not insurmountable. The God has given enough wisdom and experience for us. Any type of situation we can emerge back, because we are always investor friendly, customer friendly. As long as the customers are with us, there is no question of any fall for us. These things will always come and go. Sometimes it may come at a cyclical impact. Some other time it may be a structural impact. Some other time it may be of a permanent nature. Some other time it may be of a temporary nature. These things we cannot avoid. This is bound to happen. These are all real predicament. But at the same time, the mitigation plan, what I told you, how to improve your pricing power, what I told you, how to improve the market share or at least retain what I told you, how best you can make use of the technology at your command to get into all sort of information. These are all the things if you are going to strictly follow with the team and to try to run the company within its parameters, not diverting any money. Don't imitate anybody. Get into the very fulcrum of return on investment as the main mantra for success. If you are able to maintain your stock turnover based on the stocking, do not fall prey to the appreciation of the gold, but go into the earnings what the gold will make for you. And try to behave yourself and present yourself to the customer in a way in which it is very, very facilitating for them to get into the groove. If these are all the ways you are able to manage, I am sure future is certain. You are all capable of making it again. This industry is not a small one-time industry. It is not a new generation industry. People may call it a sunset industry. Even in sunset industry, there are ample scope for improvement. This a sort of cannibalism is now taking place by virtue of all your efforts, but your continued support and continued discipline of not borrowing more than 1/3 of the total working capital requirement. Make it your own way. Ask your consultant, they will be able to give you and draft it out to you. Once that is done, I'm sure that you will definitely emerge as a rebounding success in this jewelry industry, as you always been in the earlier years also. With that, I now request the audience to initiate an interactive session. And it is my privilege to find an answer for such issues raised by you. In case you come across any doubt or clarification connected with this talk, you may write to me even at a later date. To the extent possible, within my knowledge and wisdom, I will definitely try to answer you and try to give you a comfort for your clarification, whatever have been sought. With that, happy days here again for the industry. Please manage yourself, manage your funds, manage your resources. Thank you very much for passion hearing you had. It's a very, very difficult subject. I never entertained you with any other illustration. I never given you any jokes in the last 60, 65 minutes of talk. everything very very cordial atmosphere, everything happened. I'm once again sincerely apologize. I don't know Hindi. I can understand Hindi, but I cannot talk at length as that of English or Tamil. Anyhow, Mr. Vinoji will take it forward to you, and I look forward for a very enterprising interactive session. With that, I'm handing over to Mr. Vinoji, sir. Thank you.
Mr. Rajagopalan, if you were in a normal situation in a physical meeting, everybody would have given you a standing ovation. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. We've had some very good questions that have come up. One of the points, I'll try to take up one question at a time. I don't mind unmuting everybody, but it may become very noisy. But if everybody can be disciplined, we can try to unmute. Nevertheless, I'll start with the first question. Ye pehla question, this is the first question. Many a times, Mr. Urish has been asking this question from Bangalore. Many a times, the departments don't accept FIFO method of valuation for inventory and insist on weighted average. What can be our stand on it is the question, Mr. Rajagopalan.
No, but this is the consistency is the only thing which is asked. FIFO is well recognized accounting standard. Weighted average also has been included. Not LIFO only is not included. So it's a well accepted norms.
Okay, Mr. Rish, I hope that satisfies the question. Any method which is consistently followed gives a better reflection of the financial. Right. One more question is from Mr. Satya. Akashia Jewelers, how to avoid income tax for the price rise for the stock we are holding? If we or our family members give our personal gold stock as loan to our company, we are liable to pay capital gains stock. Please clarify, sir.
Yes. The personal stock given as a loan to the company, it is only a loan instrument. Only capital gain will come only at the transfer. When the real sale take place, only the capital gain will come. Therefore, at an accepted value, at the time when actually the loan has been given, that value will prevail for assets and liabilities statement. Up to the, there is no, he is not transferring his rights in the property. He is only giving it as a loan. Therefore, there is no question of capital gain. That will come only when he really sells it to the company and takes the consideration. So they can continue to do that. It has been well accepted in the Northern India also. So many cases we attended, we got it. Especially in the disclosure schemes and all.
Another question from Mr. Ahmed. Is,
can you remove the presentation so that we can see you fully, sir?
Yes, sir. If you can exit the presentation, we can put everybody on video.
Oh, actually, Swami, this presentation is good, sir. But everyone can speak.
Can we have your presentation as a PPT?
Yes, I will remove it.
For our Mindspeak group?
Yes, removed, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, now I am able to see.
Mr. Rajagopalan has sent the presentation to me. I will share it and then we can upload it on the Mindspeak website as well as YouTube.
Okay.
The next question that we have is from Mr. Ahmed. How to get metal loans from bank by small jewelers?
Now they are giving 2 kg, 1 kg, up to 5 kg also they are giving. That may not be a problem. But earlier days it was 5 kg because cutting the price is very difficult. That is the reason why they were not given. They can take a bank guarantee from a designated bank and go to the metal loan wala and try to fix it at a different 2 kg, 3 kg, 5 kg. What is the smallness? And less than 10 kg, it will be difficult because the different timing frame is required.
Right.
Nothing stopping. There is no restriction that it should be 2 kg minimum. Normal token size is 5 kg.
Now, what I will do is maybe we can, I don't know, Ashok bhai, do you think we should unmute everybody?
No, that will be total chaos.
Can we try for about 1 minute and see?
People are posting their questions. Vinodji, they are posting their questions. So we can take the questions from the chat also.
All right. So we are the questions. There are more appreciation and thanks for the presentation. Questions seem that any, as they always say, if somebody speaks something and there is no clarification requested, that means the presentation is wonderful.
My it also son. Means the
yes. There is a question from Omkar Jewelers, Coimbatore. Should I go for GML or to go for CC in the current scenario? I think that was explained very clearly by Mr. Rajagopalan.
Correct. It should be GML only. Because otherwise your price will be cut at the highest level and you will continue to pay 13% interest. Whenever the prices are on the high side, you should have a unfixed quantity. We should not get your gold price fixed in the upward journey.
If there are no more questions, I believe if Nitin,
I have one question.
Sorry,
पिछले जलम में ये ज्वेलर्स थे क्या in last life? Answer question to you in your last life. I think you was a jewelers and big time jewelers.
That's all the experience I gained from people like you.
It was a wonderful talk and you were long awaited, and like you are speaking like from the your heart, and it's going touch to our heart also.
Yeah, so thank you. Can you allow Ramesh Dhawanam to speak?
Yes. Ramesh, I'll just do that 1 minute. Ramesh, you can go ahead now.
Yeah, thank you. It was a wonderful presentation. I think most of the people we are worried about our stock valuation has been. I think what we are following is cost price or market price, whichever is less, as per the accounting standard 6.
Correct.
Is it correct?
Correct. Absolutely correct.
Number two, if you can tell about about the gold metal loan, what people are asking. Okay, a lot of people are asking. I think now as the prices are going up, I am feeling a lot of people are getting into risk of not hedging it properly. So unless we have a proper mechanism of hedging properly, we should not get into the gold metal loan. Even though it looks 2% or 3% interest on the metal loan, the hedging cost is more than 6%. The rupee forward is around 5.5% and gold forward is around 1%. It is coming to 8 to 9%. You may say 1 or 2%. But I feel at this juncture, when the market is boom and volatile, nobody should enter the gold model unless you have a proper mechanism. Because I can see a lot of questions on the chats. I think I have seen a lot of people burn their fingers in that. Because you have to make the top of the margins overnight. You know, the fluctuation $50, $100 goes over in the midnight. By the time you cannot give the margins, the rate will cut. By the time morning rates will come down.
That's exactly what happened in 2013.
Yes, even now it happened, sir. So
it will also happen. Now also it will happen. Similar situation is emerging.
Yes, sir. So
that is the problem.
Because all this.
That is why we should have more cash to support the margin. We keep on giving a margin to the banker in order to maintain our unfixed status.
Yes,
once you allow them to fix it, then automatically after that it will come down. Means we will not find a buyer also. We will not. Yes, it will be a real loss to us.
No, I am seeing the prices goes up 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock.
I agree. It is a problem in India. It is for the oil industry also.
They try to do that.
Exactly, I agree. That now the price fluctuation is so. Previously, it's 1.5%. So this time, 3 to 4% price rise is going up.
But hedging cost
is inevitable. Anyway, not getting into cash credit is a good choice, sir. Why I'm telling you, here at least we are certainty about what we are losing.
Okay.
Cash credit, we also not sell. We will also continue to pay the interest.
Yes. But I think we have to hedge. If rupee head forward itself is around 5%, sir. And gold forward is, so that's why
It is always 5%, no? Premium for rupee is always 5%.
Yes.
But the MCX gives you the both the side. Rupee also they take care of. But instead, what we do, sometimes suppose we don't want metal. What is the advice I am giving to my clients is that you don't want metal, you have got enough metal. There is no real offtake from the customer, ultimate customer. The stock has to come down. But metal loan has to be cut on the day. So you pay the metal loan, use the CC, but immediately go short in your MCX. Thereby you continue to have an unfixed status.
But problem is with small jewelers.
And other when you sell, you pay it off your cash credit account.
No, no. Most of people does not have that mechanism, sir. They don't understand. Small jewelers, most
big. That is why we have to educate them, sir. The time has come. People are all cheating us.
Yes.
The bankers and the overseas people. Yes. The time has come. We have to educate them. Educate our people in a small way. They should understand because it is going to be the order of the day.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
This kind of fluctuation, nobody can take. Even the best of the company cannot take this kind of dent into their market valuation.
You're right, sir. Mr. Rajagopalan, actually, on the MindSpeak series, there have been a very, very good session in the recent times that Mr. Nitin Khandelwal has brought on hedging also. It is useful for a lot of people. Now, I think a lot of people are beginning to be a little more financially savvy. Otherwise, they were only doing day-to-day management. They were not looking at their money, finances, and balance sheets.
Correct. One time they have to look into the rearrange their affairs.
Yes, sir.
Suiting to their emotions also. Somebody may be more proactive, but a tempered way we have to do the business. Otherwise, without our knowledge, we'll be losing money. Earning 1 rupee here from the customer, we'll be losing everything in metal loan.
Sir, I have to ask you this one question from Mr. Rajendra Bola. A very interesting question. The difference between the bank rates and the open market price is a big problem in GML. Is there a suggestion, any suggestions for that?
The open market means, he means cash market.
That's it.
That's what we go only by the organized, you know. RTGS only we can relate. RTGS rate only we can relate for all our accounting purposes. But that benefits somebody, a small player, they are taking it. But right, we cannot do it across the board. No, that is not not proper.
The question that might come out of that is the competition or the price differential between the unorganized smuggled route and the official bank route for GML or CC or organized players, that difference remains. And that is probably the disrupting factor in the marketplace.
That's what I told you also. One of the risks I told you, elaborately only that. That is there. Yeah, but it gets adjusted, sir. Sometime it becomes the cash market is higher. Last week, 20 days back, cash market was higher.
Yes, sir.
Even now, it's the other way about. Now it's the other way about. It gets automatically rebalanced.
Vinodji. Yes. Vinodji, in the recent last week, when the silver price was 67,000 in MCX, the COMEX price was converting the 72,000, MCX was 67,000, and in the open market was available in the 61,000.
Correct.
There was 5,000 difference between the COMEX, MCX, and the physical market.
Correct.
And Rameshji, if you want to see the quanting of the future contract, the February contract of the 2021 is available in 52,640 only, less than 1%.
So oh my
no
God.
Need to go and hedge, huh? No need to go and hedge in the bank if you want to hedge. Then 5th April 2021 is far away. It's just 52,875. It's a less than 1.5%.
Correct.
So if you are going the open market, the contingo or the hedging cost is 5%. Here is only less than 1.5%.
We can make use of it.
I think such we should have
normally emerge. But we have to closely monitor it. Some informed person should always monitor it. Because bankers will never tell us.
Yeah.
They want to take the maximum out of the exposure.
So there is an amount of,
this is what I'm telling educative value. Only the lender should tell us. After all, it is an industry which is contributing 1,40,000 crores. It's not a mean money. 6% of the total exchequer is being contributed by the jewelry industry. It gets a stepmotherly treatment.
Absolutely.
In all walks of life, talking from the regulatory side, levy side, harassment side, income tax addition, high-pitched additions. How many high-pitched additions this time has come, no?
Too much, sir.
Absolutely nonsense. Not even, but, it will not test scrutiny even any court.
But we have gone for appeal, sir. We have gone for appeal.
Everybody has gone on appeal. We will definitely win.
You have no option.
No option. But it tells upon the people, no, the equilibrium, mental equilibrium getting disturbed, no?
Yes.
Yeah. Because whether I have to be in business, why should I take this kind of challenges, sir? People are asking, no.
You have to pay 20%. To go for appeal, we have to pay 20%. That is also a problem.
And that is, even the 20% is a big money.
Yes, sir.
Because high pitched means a 10 crores fellow, you put 100 crores, ask me to 20 crores. It is wash away my balance sheet.
Yes.
But ultimately, we are getting the good result. High pitch, and high pitch is not popular. Even the lawyers and chartered accountant don't know the high pitch, how to make the high pitch and why to make high pitch. Even I own the high pitch. Assessment order.
So great. I think it was a wonderful session. I have unmuted everybody. Ask them to unmute if they wish to ask for a minute or so. If not, then we could wind up the session. It has been absolutely wonderful, sir. I would like to now take it to Mr. Ashok Meenawala so he could, you know, take it forward.
Thank you.
Ashokji.
Thank you, Vinod. First and foremost, sir, I must tell you that you have discussed six chapters today. I think this is the finance Bhagavad Gita in the true sense. These are six chapters of the of finance related to the Bhagavad Gita in the true sense. The kind of points that you have really told us, the non-stop way in which you have communicated, sir, I can only tell you this is a job of a Shankaracharya who has an authority over a particular thing, and you are actually, sir, the Shankaracharya of the financial market, and sir, we bow down to you. On behalf of the gem and jewelry industry, with the kind of knowledge and the insight that you have about our industry and the way and the strength at which you have affirmed our belief is absolutely unbelievable, sir. You have made us realize too many things today, sir. We have opened our eyes, we have opened our minds, we have opened our hearts today, sir. I have a long list of every single word you have spoken, sir. I have put it down. And I don't know where to start and where to end. It can run. It runs into pages of my scripting that I have kept. And if I start talking about each and everything, I think I will need another 15-20 minutes just to relate to this. But we have all heard this from you, sir. And I can tell you, this is our 63rd or 64th edition of MindSpeak. We have received almost 175 speakers so far, sir. But I can tell you one thing, sir. This is one session with the kind of intelligence, with the kind of insight, and with the kind of knowledge that you have given, with the kind of authority which you have really showed us the direction and the way in which we have enjoyed every single word you have said, sir. There was absolute 160 people have actually put in their full concentration on everything you have spoken, sir. I can assure you one thing, sir. This session will be uploaded on the YouTube by tomorrow. And hundreds and hundreds and probably thousands of people will again see this at their convenience. Not everybody is generally free on a Sunday evening. And we hope that, sir, we can benefit from all your teaching, from all your advices, and for all the insight that you have given us. Sir, I can only give you, in my small capacity, to thank you immensely, sir, for your contribution, for your time, for your knowledge. We have enjoyed every moment of it, and my really heartfelt gratitude for everything, sir.
Ashok bhai, we can request for another subject because he is having the thorough knowledge, and he is come up with a very good PPT and thorough knowledge PPT. So we'll definitely request once more.
Yes, I also agree, Mr. Rajagopalan.
another area of focus for the industry. We can speak off afterwards, and then at your convenience, again on a Sunday or any day convenient as everybody decides, we could probably take one more session.
Very nice. Always I am at your disposal.
So nice.
Interest of the industry. Thousands of people are. For my age, that system, it has to go into the root level, and everybody should be benefited. We are all doing honest people. We want to thrive in a very honest way. And I'm very, very thankful to you. For initially, I thought it is going to be a very treacherous and rigorous thing. But ultimately, the response which I am getting from you all people, I am really glad. And no words to express my thanks to you. I will
thank you so much,
part of you. For any doubts or any clarification from any corner, you may please call me. I'm always available. It is my bounden duty to respond to you. It is my passion to discuss.
Thank you
very much, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Wish you a very happy weekend and a wonderful day ahead, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you,
sir.